Hey, thank you so much for that introduction, Joe. Just give a quick pause to make sure that you can get recording. Looks like we're good to go. Well, thank you guys so much for joining this webinar this afternoon. Looks like there's about 140 people, which is fantastic. I know not everybody's from Minnesota, but I know in the summer, you're kind of taking your chances having a Friday afternoon webinar. So I'm so happy to see so many people attending. To hear our conversation around homelessness in Minnesota, which is something that's so timely and so important. All right, so just a little bit of background. Joe gave a great introduction, but my name is Rebecca Sales. I'm a research scientist at Wilder Research in St. Paul, Minnesota. So again, for those of you that maybe aren't familiar, St. Paul is one of the Twin Cities, so Minneapolis and St. Paul, so we're in central Minnesota. Wilder Research is a nonprofit research and evaluation group, and we work with nonprofits, for-profit organizations, community leaders, government agencies, foundations, policymakers. We really work with everybody, and in addition to doing work around housing and homelessness, we work in areas such as healthcare, public health, early childhood education, criminal justice, substance abuse. So really covering all the health and human service topic areas. So we work, do a lot of work and work with a lot of really great organizations. So a little bit of background about Wilder's housing and homelessness work before we jump into the actual data. So Wilder did their first housing survey in 1917. So we've been around for a while. The foundation has been around for quite some time. We were in 1917 contracted with the city of St. Paul to look at housing conditions in the city of St. Paul. And even back then, the report found that housing could be a menace to the health and safety and privacy of thousands of St. Paul people. So this is definitely not a new issue, but it's kind of interesting to see the history of the work that we have here at this organization. So bringing it up to speed, a few more recent research studies that we've done. So homelessness and near homelessness on Minnesota's American Indian reservations, supportive housing outcomes study, homelessness and near homelessness in Appleton, Wisconsin, best practices for improving health outcomes for people experiencing homelessness, and that's was a Minnesota Department of Human Services project around Medicaid. And then of course, the namesake kind of that brings all this data together is the Minnesota Homeless Study. That's gonna be where all of the data is coming from for this presentation today. A little bit of background on the study. So the Minnesota Homeless Study is a statewide study that Wilder Research has done every 3 years since 1991. So we've been at it for quite some time now. The study consists of two parts. So the first part is going to be pretty comprehensive interviews with people experiencing homelessness. So those are going to take anywhere from probably 40 to 60 minutes, but let's say 45 minutes on average. And the survey has changed a bit over time. But again, these are face-to-face interviews. And they really ask, as you could tell from probably the length of the interview, a really comprehensive set of questions. So we ask about, you know, housing history, past experiences with homelessness, current experiences with housing, health, employment, really all of the key areas, asking questions about family and connections and kind of involvement with service systems. So really getting a rich understanding of the experiences of people experiencing homelessness. And so then the component, kind of the second component that goes along with the interviewing is a census count. The census count is actually a one day, and I should say that all of the interviewing is done on one day every 3 years. And so the census count is also a count of everybody across the state of Minnesota who is homeless on that one day. So the interviews are kind of a smaller group of that larger census count. The interviews are completely voluntary, although people are compensated in a minor way for their time, just to acknowledge that they are, you know, giving an hour of their time to us. So who is included in this? So when the study first started, you know, back in the 90s and into the early 2000s, it was primarily focused on shelter programs. So emergency shelters, transitional housing, battered women shelters. And they're all still included in the study as well. But over time, there was more of a call from the housing service providers in the community to understand more about what is going on and what the experiences are of people outside the formal shelter system. And so that was added sometime later. And so now it really is looking at those in the formal shelter system as well as those who are not in the formal shelter system. And because this has been going on since 1991, if any of you are familiar with kind of how housing and the homeless service field has changed since then, there have been a variety of other kind of point in time counts, the PIC count, and different data collection strategies that are in place now that weren't back in 1991. And you'll see on the side, I have a continuum of care regions map. And so these are all, the state is broken out into these regions. So these are kind of defined by HUD, and we kind of utilize these regions as a way to organize our interviewing, and each region, there's a certain, kind of type of organization within it. And so we work really closely with the continuum of care coordinators, as well as all the service providers in those regions to make this happen. Our most recent study, so just this past year, October 25th of 2018, we ended up utilizing 1,200 volunteers, and that consists of program staff who are doing the volunteering at their own programs, as well as volunteers that Wilder recruits and then assigns to particular programs that need support in order to be able to participate. And we were doing interviewing at approximately 400 sites on October 25th, 2018. So as I said, it's a statewide effort. It's a very comprehensive effort. And then you'll also see, in terms of reporting, so we collect all of this information, what are we doing with it? So there's kind of two different ways that we go about reporting. We do have data tables. So we take all of the data that we get and put it in some data tables that are broken out kind of by region, gender, some of the key characteristics, and those are all posted on our website, mnhomeless.org. You can see that that's what the picture is on the right. And then we also, of course, do a bunch of very comprehensive reports. So usually first comes some of the summary reports so that we can get out our initial kind of observations of the data. And then further down the line are the more comprehensive reports with much more in-depth analysis. So this PowerPoint came at a really interesting time. October 25th, 2018 seems like a very long time ago, but in terms of sort of the age of the study and how long things take, it really isn't that long ago. So what we have out right now are the 2018 counts data. So that's really a count of everybody across the state. And then just some initial findings or characteristics from the interview data. So we'll have a few different pieces here of 2018 data, as well as the deep dive that we did in 2015. So this is looking at counts. Again, that's the count of everybody in shelter and not in shelter in Minnesota on October 25th, 2018. You can see the trend lines there. The big thing with this that I want to say, though, is we know that this is always an undercount. On any given night, you will not be able to find every person that is experiencing homelessness in the state. So we definitely acknowledge that. But still to see these numbers and knowing that's an undercount is really saying something. So you can see that over time, the trend is very clearly going up. We ended up identifying 10,233 individuals on October 25th, 2018. So that's about a 10% increase from 2015. So we saw a little dip between 2012 and 2015 and then kind of bumped back up again. You can see below the total count, we have a breakout of children with parents. And so I think this point always really hits home with people as well to see that, there are more than 3,200 kids who are homeless with their parents on that night. Really, I think, gives some people a different perspective on who is really experiencing homelessness. And I should say as well, All of this information is from our kind of general statewide study. We do also do a companion study working collaboratively with most of the American Indian reservations across the state. And so that information will be released as well at a later time, but that's kind of a companion to this overall Minnesota statewide homeless study. And so how do those 10,233 people break out? Well, we see that, 32% are kids age 17 or younger with their parents. 15% are identified as unaccompanied youth, age 24 and younger. Unaccompanied youth means that they are not staying with a parent or guardian, parent or guardian, that they're on their own, but they could be on their own with their own child. And the reason that sometimes the age of 24 catches some people off guard, that is based on how HUD has defined youth. So that has changed a little bit over time, but currently it is up through 24. So that is why we have it broken out in that way. But then you can also see adults 25 to 54 make up 43%, and then 10% is older adults age 55 plus. So initial findings, so now we're moving from the counts information, which is everybody, to looking at just some initial observations of the actual interview data itself. And so this is that smaller group of about 4,700 people that were interviewed. And what we see from this data are a few things really rising to the top. Availability of affordable housing is still a really critical issue that needs to be addressed. So when we look at adults who were interviewed, their top reasons for leaving their last regular housing included being evicted. So about 4 in 10 people, 38% of people reported not being able to afford their housing, and 31% of people reported the primary reason being that they had lost their job or had their hours cut. So as you can imagine, some of those are intertwined a little bit, but when we're asking about primary reason, those are what people identified. And so kind of along with that is thinking about the fact that shelter and subsidized housing capacity is just not sufficient for the current need. So 32% of adults were turned away from a shelter in the last 3 months due to lack of space. So that is actually somebody showing up at a shelter and saying, "We're full, we don't have a bed for you tonight." 50% of people interviewed were on a subsidized housing waiting list on October 25th, 2018, so half of the population. And of those people who were on a list on that day, they had on average been on the list for 12 months. So there is not a lot out there in terms of capacity. And when you can get on a list, you most likely are going to be on a list for a while. So people often are just kind of cobbling things together in the meantime to bide their time until they can get into a different housing situation. One of the other big things that came out of this for us is we saw that more people are staying outside of the formal shelter system. And so this can show up in a few different ways. For some of you, if you're more familiar with housing services, or maybe you work in housing or homelessness fields, this is very obvious to you. But for others, it's a little bit less clear. So staying outside the formal shelter system for our purposes and for our study can mean a couple different things. So it can mean staying outside, and that could literally be what people kind of stereotypically think of when they think of someone experiencing homelessness. So somebody staying, outside downtown Minneapolis, sleeping on a park bench. That's one thing. It could be somebody camping, sleeping in a tent. It could be somebody staying in a building that, an abandoned building that's not intended to be lived in. But the other piece of people staying outside of the formal shelter system is also people being doubled up. And what that means is people are could be on a very short-term basis, staying with a friend, maybe staying with a family member, maybe staying with somebody they don't know, but it's staying in an actual housing situation, but it's very short-term. You might call it couch hopping. So that's kind of the other way that people are able to stay when they're not in the formal shelter system. So when we look at the responses from people that we had talked to, we see that 27% of adults had reported that they had spent more than 1 week outside in the past month. So we have a question that says, you know, tell us how many days within the past 30 days you've stayed at any of these places, and we write in numbers. And so 27% of adults reported staying more than a week outside in the past month. And then we see 22% of youth age 24 or younger reporting that. And then when we look at the doubled up piece, we see 17% of adults had spent more than a week doubled up in the past month, and 38% of youth. There's a much bigger difference in percentages there. And for us, that's not too terribly surprising. We do see more often than not that youth are more likely to stay outside of the formal shelter system. They are more likely to be couch hopping with friends or, family members, but a lot of times friends. So that is not too terribly surprising when we end up seeing that. We also see some pretty considerable overrepresentation of certain groups in the homeless population. So here we have a chart that shows a comparison of the Minnesota adult population in blue, and then the homeless study adult population in orange, and the homeless study adult population is those that we interviewed. And we see people identifying as Black or African American and those identifying as American Indian are far overrepresented in the homeless population in comparison to the overall Minnesota adult population. And this is a trend that has been fairly persistent over time, and I will say a little bit more about this later. But we also do see overrepresentation in the LGBTQ community as well. So of those we interviewed, 22% of homeless youth identified as being part of the LGBTQ community, as well as 10% of homeless adults. So now we're going to switch gears just one more time, and we're going to look at our 2015 data. This is where we really did a much deeper dive because we've had time to kind of digest it all. We've done a lot of different reports in terms of a full report and then some subpopulation reports. And so all of this we are currently in the process of doing as well for the 2018 data. So if you are interested, please go to mnhomeless.org and you can sign up to receive alerts when we do publish either new data tables or new reports. So we're going to look at the five reasons that we have identified that people are homeless as a result of what we're seeing in the interview data. And the first thing being a lack of employment. For people experiencing homelessness, it's hard to get and keep a job. So in 2015, we saw that 30% of people were employed and 14% of people were employed full time. So those numbers are very low. It's going to be hard to have enough income to afford housing, especially non-subsidized housing, if you don't have decent employment, especially thinking about the Twin Cities, the cost of housing is quite high. And there's a lot of challenges that come along with that. If you are doing a resume and you are currently staying in a shelter, what address do you put for your resume? You don't have a car and the shelter you're staying at isn't close to public transportation. Once you get that job, how do you get to work? Once you figured out how to get to work, if you are staying in a shelter or a more communal setting and you can't get any sleep, or you don't have, there's not enough space to get ready for work in the morning, those are all things that make getting and keeping a job really difficult for people who are experiencing homelessness. Here are some employment rates among homeless adults over time. So, as you might expect, these do mirror somewhat to what the overall economy was experiencing. So you can see the overall low is in 2009, kind of in accord with the Great Recession. And then since then, we've slowly been creeping back up. But the highest numbers that we have seen, at least in this time frame that we're looking at, were back in 2000, where we saw that 41% of homeless adults were employed. So another reason that people end up being homeless or have, you know, a difficult time with housing is there's just not enough affordable housing. I mentioned this when I was talking about the initial 2018 data. In 2015, we saw nearly half of homeless adults were on a waiting list for subsidized housing. And another 14% couldn't even get on a waiting list because it was closed. So, you know, when you think about the number of barriers that are stacking up for people, it's, is there subsidized housing? No. Okay. Let me get on a wait list for subsidized housing. Can I get on a wait list for subsidized housing? No, I can't. Okay. Now I have to kind of bide my time before I can even get on a wait list for subsidized housing. So these are all challenges that definitely continue to compound for people in these situations. Like I had mentioned in the beginning, so Twin Cities, for those of you who are not from Minnesota, the Twin Cities are Minneapolis, St. Paul, and the surrounding suburbs. So looking at Twin Cities metro incomes of older adults versus housing costs, and again, this is 2015, we see the median income was reported at $550 a month, whereas the median rent is $950 a month. I anticipate that when we look at these numbers again this year, the rent is going to continue to increase. And I believe this is for a one-bedroom apartment. It's just with such a huge gap there's really not a lot you can do. And it's really difficult to kind of make that up in income, given the situation that a lot of people are in. So the third thing that we see is many people experiencing homelessness face a lot of obstacles to maintaining their housing. And one of the big ones that we see are chronic health conditions that people are experiencing. Serious mental illness impacts around 60% of people who are experiencing homelessness. Chronic physical health conditions around 50%, and substance use disorder around 21%. And as the diagram shows, there's definitely considerable overlap with these. The note on the bottom indicates that, you know, only 22% of people that we talked to in 2015 didn't have any of these challenges. So you're really looking at 3/4 of people having one of these physical or mental health challenges that is going to make it difficult to obtain or maintain housing. Is a trend line over time of chronic health conditions. So you can see that with the exception of substance use disorders, they have slowly crept up over time, upwards of 50% in 2015 for mental and physical health conditions. We see that 1 in 3 women reported that they had last left their housing because of abuse. Violence is something that we do see coming up in the data. So, you know, part of it is on the front end where people are leaving housing because of violence. And we can look at this in terms of adults fleeing domestic violence, as well as youth who may be experiencing violence in their households who are leaving for that reason. But we do also know that violence does persist within the, once people are homeless, that is something that does occur and people experience as well once they become homeless. And then we see 1 in 3 adult women have been in jail or prison, and 2 in 3 homeless adult men have been in prison. So again, this is just another thing that's compounding people's ability to access housing in the way that they need to, even if it is available. So the fourth thing is that we know homelessness is often preceded by childhood trauma and abuse. So nearly 4 in 10 adults reported being physically abused as children. And we know that 46% of youth report being physically abused as a child. When we look at a more complete breakdown of the adverse childhood experiences that we ask about, we see that nearly 3/4 of adults report experiencing at least one of these things, and nearly 9 out of 10 youth age 24 or younger report experiencing at least one of these things. So, I mean, those are some pretty significant numbers, especially when you're thinking about, you know, abuse they've experienced, neglect, out-of-home placements, These are things that definitely have an impact in the present for people as well as they carry forward into the future. So fifth, we know that there is a ripple effect from discriminatory practices. We know that not just in Minnesota, but throughout the country, that there is a history of discriminatory policies that disproportionately impact people of color. I had mentioned this from the 2018 data, but even jumping back to 2015, we see that African Americans make up a disproportionate percentage of the homeless population. So 39% of adults experiencing homelessness are African American, whereas the population in Minnesota was only 5%. Similar with American Indians being far overrepresented in the homeless population. And again, similar, so you can see these trends carrying from 2015 to 2018. The LGBTQ community is also disproportionately impacted. In 2015, 9% reported identifying as LGBTQ, and for youth it was 17%. So I'm just going to talk a little bit, kind of take this information, reframe it a little bit, and talk about people experiencing homelessness who are kind of at different phases of their lives. So looking at kids all the way up through older adults. So first we're going to look at kids and families. And again, thinking back to the overall counts data, we know that there are upwards of 3,000 kids experiencing homelessness with their parents. So we know that kids experiencing homelessness often have health and developmental challenges. Homeless parents reported that 16% of their kids did not receive dental care in the past year. A quarter said they had a child with an emotional or behavioral problem. Nearly half said they had a school-aged child with a learning problem. And 34% said their child had been a victim of bullying. And so when I look at this, you know, thinking about any parent, these are all things that all parents worry about, try to address, probably lose sleep over at times. And, you know, so thinking about that as a parent yourself, and then thinking about taking away, you know, a house as a sense of security, as a sense of safety, and trying to still figure out how to address these and ensure your kid gets to school and is able to navigate all of those things. It just becomes exponentially more difficult to do that when a family is experiencing homelessness. So I'm just going to take a quick look at homelessness youth on their own in Minnesota. So again, these are kids who are not with their parents. We see that kids who aren't with their parents, about a little bit more than half are female. 18% identify as part of the LGBTQ community. Most are born in the United States. 72% grew up in Minnesota. And 73% identify as persons of color. So again, persons of color are disproportionately impacted, especially so in looking at youth. So key findings that we identified in looking at youth data in 2015, youth, as I mentioned before, actually, are least likely to use shelters. So again, they are quite commonly doubled up or couch hopping, and many of them are long-term homeless. Many often have children of their own. So you have, you know, a 18-year-old experiencing homelessness on their own, and then they have a child who they're trying to navigate the world for as well. Again, just compounds the challenges they might experience. Youth experiencing homelessness are disproportionately people of color. They often have serious mental and physical health issues. They often have at least one adverse childhood experience. Again, 9 out of 10 have at least one adverse childhood experience. And they often experience violence and exploitation related to their housing and homelessness situation. So in a previous slide, I had mentioned 1 in 3 women left their last housing due to violence, but this could also be the case for youth as well, where they're leaving because of a bad situation with their family or whoever they're staying with on a long-term basis, and then they become homeless and end up experiencing violence and exploitation in that respect as well. So now we're going to jump up to older adults, and you know, I should just provide a little bit more context kind of about why we look at kids and older adults. And a lot of times, again, I had mentioned before kind of what the everyday person who isn't familiar with this thinks about when they're thinking about people who experience homelessness. They don't think about, you know, a family with small children sleeping in a tent or staying in a camper. And they don't think about somebody's, you know, 70-year-old grandpa who got discharged from the hospital and can't go back to the nursing home and then suddenly is showing up in a shelter with his oxygen tank. I wish that story was made up, but it is not. These are the things that homeless service providers are very familiar with, as well as anybody who has volunteered or done anything in that arena. You know, I think expect the unexpected, and it can be really challenging to see. But there's a lot of great people out there doing really fantastic work. So for older adults, we kind of look at it as a good news, bad news setup. So it's a relatively small number of older adults who are experiencing homelessness in Minnesota. Adults age 55 and older are only 9% of the homeless population. So this is 2015 compared to 2019. We did see a little bump in that. When we look at numbers between 2009 and 2015, we see some pretty continual increases from 09 to 12 to 15. And that's maybe not, if anybody's kind of familiar with community statistics and metrics, most states are seeing increases in their older adult population. So for the most part, they are trending somewhat similarly over time. And when we look at the older adult population who are experiencing homelessness, what we end up seeing are 73% are male, 31% of those men had reported serving in the US military. Most are born in the United States. 63% have lived in Minnesota for 20 plus years, and 52% are persons of color. So at least in Minnesota, we definitely see that in general, even in the overall population, that youth are more racially diverse versus older adults tend to be less racially diverse. So when you think about I think 73% of homeless youth were persons of color versus 52% of homeless older adults. So when we look at key findings related to older adults, we see that even though they're a small age group, they really are one of the fastest growing age groups. Most older adults experiencing homelessness are under the age of 75, and a lot of them don't become homeless until age 50 or later. So that I think kind of shows up in a couple different ways, in that they may not become homeless until later, but if you work with homeless older adults or have any interaction with them, you may notice that they could possibly seem older than you think they are, just because, you know, when talking about all the challenges that people face, that's compounded with age. And, you know, living as a homeless person is very, very stressful and very difficult. So that compounds any of the conditions they face as well. And they do suffer from a lot of complex health conditions. Even though older adults are less racially diverse, people of color are still disproportionately showing up in the homeless population in this age group. We know that older adults rely on public benefits, and we know that they are still hindered by a criminal background or chemical dependency as well. So this is kind of like where the rubber hits the road. What can we do about this based on what we're seeing in the data? And when it comes to taking action, these are the points that we've pulled out. And the first is we would need to address gaps between income and rent. I think there was a $400 or $500 gap between income and rent. And it's going to be really difficult for somebody to overcome that on their own. So thinking about, you know, in what ways can that be addressed or efforts be supported that can close that gap. We know that to address this in a meaningful way, if we could intervene early to address a cycle of poverty and homelessness and some of the intergenerational poverty and homelessness, we could prevent a lot of this from happening. So thinking about improving supports for people overall, but also thinking about families with kids and kids who are homeless on their own is really important. Thirdly, to address it, we would want to increase and improve supports that will help keep their housing. So again, thinking back to that long line of, is there housing? Can you get on a waiting list for housing? You know, what do you do until you can get on a waiting list? Once people get that housing, what can we do to make sure that people keep it? What does that look like? Is it that there are policies that are making it difficult for people to keep it? Is it something within their lives or a more environmental factor that's making it difficult for people to keep housing? You know, how can we try and support that stability? And then lastly, addressing systemic inequalities. I had mentioned a bit before about just, you know, historically there have been discriminatory policies that definitely disproportionately impact people of color. When we think about, you know, how they're involved in the criminal justice system, how they're treated by the criminal justice system, how that impacts people's ability to get housing, how families could be separated or have been separated when you're thinking about systems involvement with child protection. And all of those things are in flux, but knowing that even if policies change, there is still that historical piece that doesn't change overnight. And so being really thoughtful about how that can be impacted is really important. So I do absolutely want to give a special thanks to our funders and supporters listed here. Every year, Wilder works extremely collaboratively with all of these people to ensure that we're able to do this and we can get all the reports written and we can coordinate all the volunteers and do it in a really meaningful way. I don't have them listed here, but if anybody is on this webinar who volunteered or is part of a program that was a site for the homeless study, we cannot thank you enough. It is not possible without the collaboration and willingness by all these participants. So it's truly a huge lift and it provides really meaningful information that can be used to really support these efforts in the long term. So if you want to know more, and hopefully now you're like, yes, I want to know more. I want to see all of the 2018 data. I want to read all the reports. Again, you can go to mnhomeless.org. We have the interview data tables, which are publicly available. The 2018 ones just got put up a day or two ago. You can see the full 2018 initial observations characteristics report, the counts data. So the overall count of everybody was released a little while ago. And then in the fall of this year, we should be having our comprehensive report for 2018 with a lot of additional analysis that we will do, or I should say, are doing. And if anybody works in the homeless industry, housing industry, and you have a particular interest in the data, or you know, there's something you feel like you could really use, we do on a very select basis work with people to provide data and do some additional analysis. So we can definitely be reached for that as well. So if you have any questions, you can always send me an email or go to our website and email somebody else as well. So that is it for me today. I've been seeing a little blinking going on up in the screen. So I'm guessing there are at least a few questions.
Yes, thank you, Rebecca. We do have a few questions for you. First one, Peter asks, how can mental health and substance use providers help with this issue of homelessness in Minnesota?
Yeah, that's a really great question. So I'm sure there's ways that they can continue to help. I know that they're, so we do actually do a lot of work with substance abuse treatment and recovery programs, as well as mental health service providers, as well as homeless service providers, and we know that there really is quite a bit of collaboration already going on between those different pieces, because, you know, as you saw in the data, a lot of it's very intertwined in terms of reasons for why people may enter homelessness or have difficulties obtaining housing once they have gone through treatment. But I know one of the challenges for a lot of like the treatment programs, for example, that we work with is just they don't have places to refer people to. The, you know, they're referring people to waiting lists, or the waiting lists are full. And so, you know, I think beyond just continuing to collaborate and ensuring that to the extent possible, the left hand and the right hand know what's going on and understanding the connections between these things, that's really important. And then I think just taking it to a policy level as well and ensuring that there are resources that well-meaning staff can ensure that they can provide to people, you know, once they are in a good place with their recovery or, you know, stabilizing their mental health, that then they can transition into a supportive living environment and they can maintain that positive status.
Great, thank you for answering that question. Donna has a question. Does this data, I assume the data you presented today, does this data go to organizations that can get more affordable housing built and off the ground available to folks?
Yeah, so this data is publicly available to everyone. Like I said, it's posted on our website. So we really encourage anyone to use it, you know, for their purposes. We actually, the team that I am on, and I should say kind of my place with all of this is I coordinate all of the homeless service providers that participate in the study every year, as well as, of course, writing reports and doing all that stuff. We have a fairly small team. But yeah, this is all publicly available to everyone, all of the reports, the data tables. So I encourage people, if they have questions about the data, to first go to our website and take a look. And if you feel like you're not finding what you think you should be finding, to reach out to myself or somebody else on my team and make sure that you can find what you're hoping to be able to use for your organizational purposes.
Great. So everyone, there is that data is a resource on their website, mm-hmm. Which is on the slides, and Rebecca's slides will be attached to the email with your evaluation and post-test. We have just a couple more questions here. Roshan says, I saw the suggestions on how to reduce the homeless population, but I guess I missed exactly how you were able to impact change in Minnesota, and where's the data to reflect the reduction of homelessness based on these tactics?
Sure. So, we are not necessarily the change makers. We are the ones that are kind of laying the groundwork for it by saying, like, this is what we're seeing as the challenges that people are facing. So we do this work, like I said, in collaboration with a lot of different organizations. And so we ensure that these organizations have the information that they need to be able to identify policy priorities that fit them best. So, you know, for example, if we're working with a provider in northern Minnesota, we help them get the information they need to develop a plan for how to best address homelessness in their area, which could potentially look significantly different than those in the Twin Cities metro. And in terms of, I think the second question was how, where is the data to see if this has made an impact? Was that correct, Joe?
Yes.
Yeah, we don't necessarily have outcomes data per se. We don't like follow up with the same group of people over time and say, okay, how are you doing now? This is all an anonymous survey. We don't collect any identifying information. We collect a lot of information, but no identifying information. We do look a lot at trends in the data that we have. And so we look at that in comparison to different policies or things that have been going on socially that may have a difference. So, you know, in looking at the data around the Great Recession, we saw a lot of impacts in terms of, you know, employment, income, and a lot of different stressors in that way. But we don't necessarily, you know, identify policy objectives as a result and then implement them ourselves.
Perfect. Thank you. We have a question. Chandy asks, does this data support mental health clients who have a history of civil commitments? I often come across clients being denied housing due to this history of commitment.
I don't know necessarily. I'm sure you could use the data and find information that may provide more context for that. I am not aware of or worked with anybody that has used it in that particular way. But again, I would encourage you to, I think it's broken down. We have one section for like physical and mental health questions. And so you could take a look at that. I don't think that we have any questions in the data set specifically asking about civil commitments though.
Thank you for that. Peter asks, of those who do get subsidized housing, do you see many of the conditions that initially cause homelessness improve?
I'm pausing because I'm kind of trying to think of other work that we've done in this area. This particular set of data doesn't necessarily speak to that, but there's kind of a few different schools of thought in terms of, you know, taking a housing first approach and ensuring that people have supportive housing and then kind of getting all the other things in place. So I don't specifically know in that regard, and this particular study doesn't seek to answer that question.
Okay, thank you. Patricia asks, what is the difference with metro area versus greater Minnesota? Can you comment on that?
Sure, yeah, absolutely. So we see, I'm thinking back to some of the trends this year from metro and greater Minnesota. We saw some similar trends this year. People in greater Minnesota in general are harder to find. So it's a lot harder to identify people who are homeless in greater Minnesota just because it's spread out over a much larger land area. I feel like are more likely to not be as connected to services. You know, when you think about the metro, if you are in a shelter in downtown Minneapolis, the odds of you being able to walk someplace to be able to get access some kind of support service or get on a waiting list is going to be a lot easier than if you are up in, you know, Ely and you're trying to figure out how to get someplace to identify services. We see people staying, they're a lot more like scattered in greater Minnesota as well. Greater Minnesota also tends to be a little bit older. But we have, I should say, once we do our full report, we do a lot more breakouts by geography as well as, and we actually do all the breakouts for the data by continuum of care regions. So all of those regions that were on that earlier map, you can find data by region as well as statewide.
Great, thank you. Twa asks, who are the landlords who can qualify to participate in the LTH program? What is the requirement?
Ooh, I don't know. Do not do anything with landlords.
No worries.
Yeah. Great question though, but that is not mine.
No, these are some real zingers today. Some questions. We thank you all for your questions. Let's see here. I just want to make sure we've addressed them all. It looks like that's all the questions we have for today. Do you have anything else to add, Rebecca?
You know, I don't think I do, but in the event that people have additional questions or related to housing, homeless service provision, you can definitely email me. And if I do not know the answer, we have a lot of really fantastic staff here that work with a lot of really great organizations. So I might be able to find someone to refer your question to in the event you're feeling like you're getting stuck on trying to figure something out. And so definitely reach out if you have a particular interest or a particular question that you think we can help with.
Thank you. I may have spoken too soon, Rebecca. Patricia asks, or has a comment. I thought I heard there was a large increase in homelessness in the metro area over the last counts.
Yeah, there is a large increase. We did see increase in Greater Minnesota as well. One of the things that we saw in terms of the increase in the metro is a really significant increase in those who are not in shelter. So those staying outside of the formal shelter system. And that part gets a little nuanced because in the event anybody's familiar with Minnesota and the metro or even Greater Minnesota, there was a lot of attention, especially in the past year, on an encampment. So there were a number of fairly high profile areas in the metro where people, fairly large groups of people experiencing homelessness were staying in tents. And this was true in a number of different areas. So in some ways we know, and that's identified in our various reports, that we were probably more, it was easier for staff and volunteers to find those people because there was so much attention being paid, which I think is really great to be able to bring to light people's experiences. But we also know that, you know, those people could definitely have been there in other years, but because the attention hadn't been paid in the same way and they maybe be weren't living so closely together that they wouldn't have been identified in previous cycles as easily.
Great. And Serenity has one final comment. Sure. She mentioned the youth, quote unquote youth, defined by Housing and Urban Development is up to age 24, but this does not reflect the allowed age for the current youth shelters in Minnesota, which she states is typically up to age 17. And for example, Hope House offers up to age 19.
Yeah, I so they bumped it up to 24 sometime between 2012 and 2015, and that has caused challenges for everyone, not just us in terms of trying to be able to report out the data, but also, as Serenity had stated, probably for service providers. So that is one thing. We do report the data in a variety of ways. So like the counts, for example, we do break out. There's some areas where we do break out those under 18 because we know a lot of people are still interested in the 18 and under. But that is one of those things where if somebody's looking for particular data and, you know, they are experienced in using housing data or homeless service data, that we can work with people to develop a data set for you, because we do understand that as much as we would like to report everything in all of the ways, we can't. But the way that we do this, the interview, is that everybody gets, for the most part, the same interview. We have skips built in and everything. So in terms of the analysis, we just group things in a way that matches sort of what we're required in certain ways to do. So yeah, there are a lot of things that I'm sure homeless service providers are super familiar with when it comes to like defining, you know, what is transitional housing and what is a shelter, and, you know, how beds are split, and, you know, how ages are defined. And so there's a lot of things that are defined in a certain way that on paper are one way and in practice could potentially be a different way. So it's a great observation.
Absolutely. Well, we're just about at the end of our time. I'd like to thank everyone for submitting your great questions to Rebecca today. Thank you all on behalf of the Minnesota Center for Chemical and Mental Health. Thank you all for taking the time to join us today. And we'd like to extend an extra special thanks to Rebecca Sales for sharing her great research and her time and talents with us today. Thank you, Rebecca.
Thanks so much, everybody. I appreciate you spending your afternoon with me.
Great. Have a great weekend, and we hope to see you all for our webinar special event on July 26th. Thank you very much.